There's no point having a network device without interfaces. In this video, we're going to take a look at both physical and virtual interfaces. Firstly, if we want to see a list of our interfaces, use Show Interfaces TERS. The output we're looking at here is from a switch, so we've got 12 or so. Some interfaces have an ETH switch label next to them. These are regular layer 2 ports. Others have an Inet next to them. These are interfaces with IP addresses, as you can see. Just like any other vendor, we can see if an interface is admin up or down, and line up or down. Admin down would mean the interface has been manually disabled. Line down usually means that there's nothing plugged in. Most of the interfaces that we can see here are physical, also called IFDs. We will also see logical interfaces, or IFLs, and we'll talk about IFF and IFF later. For our physical interfaces, the first few letters are the interface type. For example, GE is Gigabit Ethernet, and XE is 10 gig. These don't always make a lot of sense, unfortunately. VLAN and IRB are some of the logical interfaces that we'll come across. Both of these types map a VLAN to an IP address. The interface name has three numbers. The first is called the FPC, or Flexible Pick Concentrator. This is a fancy name for a line card. Some devices allow you to add more FPCs to get more ports. Next is the module or slot. If you have a fixed format switch, you might have some RJ45 ports and some SFP ports. These will both use different module numbers. And finally, the third number is the port number. Interface names get a little tricky when SFPs are involved. SFPs can have different speeds, as you know. One may be 10 gig, while another may be 1 gig. So on this switch, this interface could begin with a GE if it's a 1 gig SFP, or XE if it's a 10 gig SFP. However, on some routers, SFPs will always use XE. Does that sound confusing? It is. Thanks, Juniper. In this example, we have a 10 gig SFP in FPC 0, Module 1, Port 1. Therefore, the name is XE011. Each device has an out-of-band management interface. Unfortunately, the names aren't the same for all devices. Routers will generally have FXP0 as their out-of-band management port, while switches will often have ME0. But if you connect several physical switches into a virtual chassis, you will now have a virtual management port called VME0. If you're wondering, a virtual chassis is what Cisco would call a switch stack. Each switch in the virtual chassis is a separate FPC or line card. In addition to these ports, there are several internal ports. We'll have a look at some of these in video 12. You will also find that Juniper has virtual interfaces for special purposes. These are called permanent interfaces. These usually map to a special feature, like PIM for multicast. These interfaces will exist whether you're using that interface or not. Some interfaces can be unnumbered. This might be a point-to-point interface that has no IP address assigned in order to conserve IP space. In this case, the switch or router will try to use an IP from a loopback interface or the IP of a primary interface, which we can configure. There's quite a few quiz questions in this video, so I'm breaking it into a few sections. Remember to pause the video or come back later to work these out. Let's look at interface configuration. Everything is hierarchical in Junos, and interfaces are no exception. First, we have the interface itself. If the interface we are configuring is physical, then this is where we configure physical parameters. This includes duplex settings, link speed, MTU, and so on. This is also where a description goes. Most configuration goes within a container called a unit. A unit is a logical interface, the IFL that we spoke about earlier. All logical configuration goes here, and all interfaces must have them. Some devices, like regular switch ports, will only have one unit. Some interfaces, like PPP and HDLC, require that the unit number is always zero. In other cases, we can have multiple units per interface. In fact, this is how we create sub-interfaces based on VLANs. Under the unit goes a family. The family is the type of addressing that's used, like IPv4, IPv6, or Ethernet. Every unit must have at least one family. So an Inet family means an IPv4 address will be applied to the interface. An Ethernet switching family will contain VLAN information. Let's try this out on a loopback interface. This is a virtual interface, but unlike iOS, we can only have one loopback. We set the LO0 interface with unit number 100 and the Inet family. Then an IPv4 address using CIDR notation. We never use subnet masks in Junos, which is great. And for completeness, we set a description on the interface. This doesn't have to be inside the unit. Now here's a quick shortcut for you. You can simply put a dot followed by the unit number after the interface. You may be comfortable with this type of notation if you've used iOS subinterfaces before. And while we're talking about tips, I have another one for you. Let's say the loopback interface was supposed to be unit 0, not unit 100. Rather than remove the config and start again, we can just use the rename command. If we want multiple IPs on the same interface, that's fine too. Junos is different to iOS in this case. In iOS, you have to make additional IP addresses secondary. Juniper has the concept of primary and preferred addresses. Any IP that's not configured as primary or preferred is automatically a secondary address. If you have more than one IP, one of them will be primary. The primary IP is used for traffic that is sent to a remote network. The preferred IP is used for traffic being sent to the local network. If we don't choose the primary and preferred IPs ourselves, the lowest IP on the interface will be selected. Let's just add a primary and secondary IP to our lab router now. Of course, we need to remember to commit our changes when we're done. Here I'm using commit and quit, which leaves configuration mode if the commit is successful. To troubleshoot an interface, the simple option is to run show interface. We can see if the interface is up, we can see the MTU, speed, and duplex, and we can see the input and output rates in bits per second and packets per second. If that's not enough information for you, add the extensive keyword to the end. This shows us any MAC errors, interface alarms, and so on. If that's still not enough, you can use a special loopback adapter to test for packet loss. And when I say loopback, in this case I mean a physical device that you can plug into the interface. With this connected, we add the GigEther Options loopback setting to the interface that we want to test. There's a link in the description if you want to learn more. If you need to disable an interface, just set the disable keyword on the interface itself. This is the same thing as using a shutdown on a Cisco router. When we're ready to bring it back up, we simply delete the disable setting. Here's another trick for you. We can also use the deactivate command to disable an interface. The interesting part, though, is that we can apply this to any part of config, not just to interfaces. This way, we can still see the config, but Junos will ignore it. And now a few more questions to get you thinking. If you're having a hard time remembering some of these concepts, you might want to consider using flashcards. You can create your own, or you can get some pre-made cards from the members section of the website. Let's turn our attention to VLANs. To create a VLAN, we choose a VLAN name as well as a VLAN ID. We can also put a description on the VLAN if we want to. After committing our changes, we can see a full list of VLANs with Show VLANs. We can configure a Layer 2 Ethernet interface as an access port or as a trunk port under the Ethernet switching family. The exact command you will use will depend on how old your version of Junos is. Now that's configured, we can add members to the port. We can add one at a time, or we can use square brackets to define a list of VLANs. Just remember to put spaces between each entry. Configuring an access port is just the same, except we only have a single VLAN. I have another CLI trick for you. Now that we've got the GE000 port configured, we can copy the configuration to other ports using the copy command. This can be used anywhere in config though, not just on interfaces. Before I show you the next trick, I'm going to set up some descriptions on a few interfaces. See here that GE000 and GE001 now have the description workstations. So, when we copy interfaces, we might also want to consider using replace pattern. This uses a pattern that we want to match and a pattern that we want to replace it with. In this example, we're going to change the interface description. This is a simple example, but we could have used regex to make it fancy if we want. In the real world, we might use replace pattern to change the IPs on each interface, which would avoid IP conflicts. VLANs also allow us to create sub-interfaces. To do this, we enable VLAN tagging on the physical port. Notice that this part is not configured under a unit number. If we already have a unit configured, we can remove them or reconfigure them. Personally, I like the unit number to match the VLAN we're using. Under the unit, we can then apply the VLAN ID and assign an IP address as normal. Well, it looks like I left the address keyword out, but I'm sure you can follow what I'm trying to do. Earlier, I mentioned VLAN or IRB interfaces, which map an IP address to a VLAN. If you're coming from a Cisco background, you may have heard of this being called an SVI. VLAN interfaces and IRB interfaces are the same thing. VLAN is just used on older versions of Junos, while IRB is used on newer versions. Quite simply, we configure the VLAN or IRB interface with one or more units and assign an IP to each one. Then, under the VLAN configuration, we map the VLAN name to the virtual interface and unit number. We'll see this further in action in video 4 when we're going to configure a DHCP server. What if we're connecting a phone to a switch port? There's three parts to this. We need a voice VLAN, we need power over Ethernet, and we need LLDP. So, step one is to define a VLAN that we can use for voice. This is exactly the same as we did before. Step two is to assign this to one or more interfaces. This is not configured on the interface itself. Instead, it's under Switch Options VoIP or Ethernet Switching Options VoIP, depending on whether you have a newer or an older switch. What we're really doing here is mapping a switch port to a VLAN for voice usage. We can still keep a data VLAN on the interface itself. Next, we try to power up any connected phones using power over Ethernet. This is so very simple to configure. Under the PoE hierarchy, we just list the ports that we want PoE enabled on. Sometimes it's simpler just to enable it on all ports. And finally, phones need a way to configure themselves. Generally speaking, this is done using CDP or LLDP. CDP is Cisco specific, so we're going to use the vendor neutral option, LLDP. Well, technically, we're going to use Lldp-med, which is LLDP with some additional extensions. Just like PoE, this is quite simple. Under the protocols hierarchy, we can enable Lldp-med on whichever interface we choose, or on all of them at once. Oh, and if you're wondering, yes, we can connect Cisco phones to Juniper switches. As long as the phones support Lldp-med, they're fine. LLDP configuration is one of the tasks in the associated lab, if you want to check that out. The link is in the description. Here's another quick tip that might help. You can use the annotate commands to add comments to any part of the configuration. This makes it easier to see what's going on later if you're troubleshooting. Just a few more quiz questions for you. You're doing really well. Now you know all about interface types and how they're configured, as well as VLAN configuration. Click the video shown here to start video 4, where we'll look at configuring a DHCP server, Juniper style.